This video is sponsored by Skillshare. Please go to skl.sh/trashtheoryfree to get 2 months free.
All the songs, are they autobiographic?
Lyrically, yeah, most of it's from direct experience. Some of it is, some of it isn't. Obviously the ones where I drown aren't from direct experience.
The Cure are weird. In fact, that's part of their appeal. They are outsiders, the forgotten and the lost, and so invite that subsection of society. But what makes the band especially weird is that there's many different shades of Cure. The muted greys of 17 seconds, the candy floss pinks of Japanese whispers, through to the deep, pained purples of Disintegration. To quote The Cure's frontman, Robert Smith, "The music's always reflected to a very large degree how I am mentally." They are the only band, Smith also notes, that are routinely perceived as both suicidal and whimsical. All through the 80s, clad in black, smudged with crimson lipstick, they unleashed super sweet pop, dour goth, and everything in between. Loved by both their cult-like fanbase and the music-listening public at large, they played by their own rules. But how did The Cure morph from suicidal oddities to whimsical new waivers and back again within a decade? The Cure entered the 80s not the darkness peddlers of legend, but as a band in love with the pop infected punk of Buzzcocks or Elvis Costello. The early singles and first album, Free Imaginary Boys, gained them buzz but little else. Released in 1980, their second album, 17 Seconds, and specifically single A Forest, would be where The Cure moved towards a darker direction. From a position of hindsight, the album's inspiration seems to be the sparser, more atmospheric side of post-punk of Wire and Joy Division. But Smith spent the composition of the album listening and shaping it through the additional influence of Nick Drake's Five Leaves Left, Jimi Hendrix's live album Isle of Wight, Astral Weeks by Van Morrison, and most of all, David Bowie's Low. As a song, A Forest is not built around a hook or a chorus, but an overarching mood, that of isolation and loneliness. Lost in a forest, all alone. The instrumentation of the track consists of ample use of flange guitar with relay added for a minimalist yet expansive sound. Synth washes sit on the track like rising mist. Lowell Torhurst's drums sound hauntingly flat and breathless. Simon Gallup's ominous bass line stalks the track. Smith noted in 2004, "With A Forest, I wanted to do something that was really atmospheric and it had a fantastic sound." Label owner Chris Parry said, "If you make this sound radio friendly, you've got a big hit on your hands." I said, "But this is how it sounds. It's the sound I've got in my head. It doesn't matter whether it's radio friendly." Of the band's limited 7 days in the studio, a whole day was spent mixing A Forest. Such was Smith's devotion to the track. His faith was rewarded as the song was their debut entry in the UK singles chart, reaching number 31 and allowing them to appear on Top of the Pops. The studio version of the track is now somewhat overpowered by denser, more epic live versions, such as the one present on concert, The Cure Live, or their overextended 11-minute rendition at Rock Wurtcher, known by most as the Fuck Robert Palmer mix.
I hope you like the rest of it. Fuck Robert Palmer, fuck rock and roll!
Despite their hatred for critical labelling, A Forest was the first moment The Cure could be called goth. And the band would get darker with their next two releases. In 1982, The Cure released Pornography. If The Cure's more goth music is considered suicidal, then Pornography is inches from the endless abyss of oblivion, both sonically and literally for the band themselves. Its cacophonous drumming and icy synth work combine to create some of the most viscerally unsettling music of their career. That's the matter if we all die. NME dubbed it Phil Spector in Hell. They had cemented their reputation for being a doomy, gloomy, dismal kind of band, and it had drained Smith. When we came to do Pornography, I really thought that was it for the group. I wanted to make the ultimate fuck off record. Then the Cure would stop. You know they're out there, don't you? After taking too many drugs in the assumed last Cure tour, bassist Gadup departed, and Smith returned to a month-long detox and wrote the pop-leaning Let's Go to Bed. Depending on which interview with Smith you want to believe, the song was either a musical experiment, a label-enforced hit attempt, or based on more recent interviews, a conscious decision to go against the all-consuming goth rock or Pornography. The only way I could get Cure music played on the radio was to make something that was radio friendly. So Let's Go to Bed was entirely designed to do that. It was the only time we've ever done it to get us played on the radio, particularly in America, and it worked. The original demo, dubbed Temptation 2, doesn't sound too dissimilar to what the band had made on Pornography. Thickly rhythmic with a synth topping, the bass line and percussion seeming like a faster She's Lost Control by Joy Division. In its fully realized form, Let's Go to Bed's funky synth pop and all too blunt satirical lyrics seemed aimed at sending up Duran Duran. When asked about his greatest musical nemesis in 2017, Smith stated, "It was generally Duran Duran, which is really sad because they loved us and they used to come to our shows. But they represented everything we hated, the whole glamorous 80s consumer bullshit, this horror show that we are up against." Musically, Let's Go to Bed may not be The Cure's best work, and chart-wise it only reached number 44 in the UK, but its video featuring the band, now a two-piece, dancing about like a drunken Tears for Fears, and their willingness to experiment with the poppier new wave side of music would serve them well for the rest of the decade. Two other pop-focused tracks followed in 1983, the New Order indebted The Walk and the Aristocats jazz of The Love Cats, all later released as the Japanese Whispers compilation. This new wave direction would make them progressively bigger worldwide. Each new single would be paired with a Tim Pope directed promotional clip, which in turn would be broadcast on MTV and increase the band's profile, especially in the States. The next few years would produce an enviable collection of singles: In Between Days, Close to Me, a re-release of Boys Don't Cry, Why Can't I Be You, and finally, their biggest hit thus far, Just Like Heaven. By 1989, Smith had grown bored with the pop-centric new wave that his band had been producing, and had retched up some more dark feelings to put to music. His main concern was that he had yet to make his masterpiece, and that all the bands he loved, respected, and was influenced by had created theirs before they turned 30, before their inevitable decline took hold. In Smith's opinion, Bowie's work fizzled out after Low, released in his 30th year. Buzzcocks' Pete Shelley was 23 when he released Ever Fallen in Love, while Joy Division's Ian Curtis would be dead by then, leaving behind both Unknown Pleasures and Closer. It was a definite fear for Smith, and this milestone was quickly approaching. So in 1988, on his 29th birthday, he began writing what would become The Cure's defining statement, Disintegration. Quizzed about its meaning, Smith stated about the album's title,
"And it was just about the sense of falling apart that I can't ever seem to shake off. But I think it's true for everyone, really. I just wanted the group, if we were going to do something else after the Kiss Me album, I knew that I wanted this to do something that had a bit of intensity to it, so that I could spend some time getting back into things that we used to do a few years ago, a bit more bite to them rather than just sort of pop stuff."
By 1989, the band's lineup bore only one similarity to the band that released Free Imaginary Boys a decade previous, Smith himself. The years since Let's Go to Bed had expanded the band from duo to five-piece, but the making of Disintegration forced Smith to finally give up on the one remaining link from their debut lineup, former drummer, now keyboardist, Lowell Tolhurst.
So Paul had to dedicate his keyboard parts to Lowell, and Lowell can't play keyboards.
Is there a danger of, like,
the
keyboard becoming a super keyboard?
What, with Lowell playing keyboards? You can't be joking. I think that he gives heart to everyone who can't play an instrument that they can still be in a group.
His alcoholism and apparent disinterest in learning and improving at his instrument had made the rest of the band hostile towards him, and his place was filled with touring keyboardist Roger O'Donnell. After 6 years of preferring the sunnier side of the pop music spectrum, Robert Smith decided to go back to where he was at the beginning of the decade. Disintegration is soaked in towering slabs of keyboards and monumental percussion. The chord progressions are affecting in how gradual they are. The whole album is a mood of its own, of dread, despair, hopelessness, and nightmarish panic, bringing together all the emotions present on 17 Seconds, Faith, and Pornography, and fusing them into something new and interesting. While the four singles all did very well, with Love Song and Lullaby showing that darkly infused pop songs can still be big hits, the album's title track is the most essential moment. The lyrics for Disintegration were the first written for the album, around the time of Smith's 29th birthday. In line with The Cure's tradition for thesis-expanding epic titular tracks is 8 minutes plus of slow-burning alienation mixed with references to addiction, fame, and infidelity. If there was a song that could be interpreted as a kiss-off to his fans, this was it. Some of the final lyrics are:
a million boats that wish to check in, stains on the carpet, stains on the ceiling, sounds like happiness, nothing dreams, every hopeless new, the ending would be.
Graham Thompson in 2018 described it thusly: Smith's voice moves from calm tenor to dislocated howl as he unleashes the most intense, involved lyric on an LP that often lets the music do the talking. It is not just the end of a relationship, it sounds like the end of everything. Critically and commercially, Disintegration is The Cure's greatest achievement. It sold 3 million records worldwide, and the resulting tour saw them selling out stadia internationally. With the 80s ending, The Cure again morphed. Now that all the darkness had been excised from Smith, he was free to write songs that expressed happiness again. 1992's Wish features one of their biggest hits, and they're most lacking in irony or edge: Friday, I'm in Love. The cycle repeated. Wild Mood Swings was akin to Kiss Me, Kiss Me, Kiss Me's genre mashup, before 2000's Bloodflowers finished the gothic trilogy alongside Pornography and Disintegration. This chameleon-like tendency, this constant state of musical flux, is what makes them the iconic band that they are. One thing that always stays the same: with every album, Smith foretells the end of The Cure. Always conscious that all things must, at some point, end. Pornography was supposed to be the end. Then, on Kiss Me, Kiss Me, Kiss Me's promotion, he knew that The Cure would be winding down soon.
We'll never go back there. I'll never go back and play a concert in America again.
Can I quote you on that?
Yeah.
The Disintegration tour, again, was supposed to be the end of the group. But this has never come to pass. The Cure are still touring, still killing it. They have festivals booked for this summer, and if you miss them, they'll probably be there for many summers to come. They are not dead. Love and great music are supposed to be fleeting, and Smith has constantly gone against that. He's been madly in love with his wife since the age of 14, and The Cure, despite what Robert Smith will say, will last forever. This video is sponsored by Skillshare. Skillshare is an online learning community for creators with more than 25,000 classes in music, design, and online media. Have you ever wanted to learn how to play the keyboard but never knew where to start? Have your present limited skills left you in danger of being kicked out of The Cure? Why not check out Arthur Bird's course on the ultimate piano chords? It's available on Skillshare Premium. Premium membership for Skillshare gives you unlimited access to all courses, so you can learn whatever, whenever, and wherever you want to learn. Whether you want to fuel your curiosity, creativity, or even get good enough at keyboards to remain in The Cure, Skillshare is the perfect place to keep you learning and thriving in 2019. Skillshare is also super affordable. An annual subscription is less than $10 or £7 a month. And if you go to the link on screen, you can get 2 months of Skillshare Premium for free. Thank you for watching. What's your favorite phase of The Cure? If you like this video, why not like, comment, and subscribe? If you really liked it and all the other videos I'm making, maybe consider contributing on Patreon. As always, I'd like to thank my fan-fucking-tastic top-tier supporters. You are all awesome. See you in 2 weeks.